political editor Gary Gibbon has this.
I would like her to put each and every one of you in my pocket and to return with you to South Africa.
Visit after visit, Nelson Mandela thanked Britain for its support for the anti-apartheid movement. Flexed across, think governments here, liberation movement or propped up apartheid.
Nelson Mandela has always been very clear with me. It was the British establishment on the wrong side of the argument.
I think he probably thought deeply down that Margaret Thatcher had done just as much as the anti-apartheid movement to produce his freedom.
The anti-apartheid movement in Britain began in the late 1950s. Protesting in front of sports venues like Lord's Cricket Ground. It was often a lonely pursuit. Even at its height, the anti-apartheid movement numbered individual membership in the low thousands. Trafalgar Square, in the shadow of South Africa House, was the regular scene for years of continuous vigil, smaller demonstrations and occasional mass rallies.
One of the most important battles of liberating South Africa was fought right here.
Passionate protest against an evil and repulsive doctrine.
Labour figures like the leader Hugh Gaitskell joined the marches, but for Labour, like the Conservatives, when they were in office, trade often trumped embargoes. Peter Hain was an anti-apartheid activist from childhood.
The Labour Party marched with the anti-apartheid movement, but in government it was much more ambivalent. Sanctions were not applied. Arms sanctions were in the end, and sporting sanctions, I had to fight a real battle with the Labour government to try and get a tough position.
Nelson Mandela first came to London in 1962. He visited Parliament, told a friend how odd it was there were no statues of black people around.
45 years later, and he saw this one unveiled. In the years in between, Nelson Mandela had returned to South Africa and been jailed by the South African regime and labelled a terrorist. And in 1979, a new leader took power here who took a pretty rigid view of that.
I will have nothing to do with any organisation that practises violence. I've never seen anyone from the ANC or the PLO or the IRA and would not do so. But the ANC says that they will target British companies. This shows what a typical terrorist organisation it is.
The advance of Soviet-backed Marxist governments in Africa in the 1980s hardened Margaret Thatcher's views on the ANC. Geoffrey Howe was Foreign Secretary under Margaret Thatcher.
The big world as a whole, the division between East and West was a very vivid, clear one. And the terrorist organisations were all equally lumped together. Three-letter words, PLO, IRA, ANC, put them to that extent in the doghouse.
Charles Pole advised Margaret Thatcher on foreign affairs and acknowledges it wasn't all about the Cold War. Race played a role too.
I think it's perfectly true that Margaret Thatcher was more instinctively sympathetic towards white people, yes. She had no experience of Africa at all.
For her to insist that she knows better than Nelson Mandela is both arrogant and absurd.
Hello, Mr. Speaker. I think the Right Honourable Gentleman possibly takes his instructions from the ANC.
Behind her on the back benches, some of Margaret Thatcher's strongest supporters were also supporters of apartheid and passionate critics of Nelson Mandela.
The man became head of the armed wing of the ANC in 1961, around that time. And they were just terrorists, no different from the Irish terrorists, perhaps no different to those we're fighting now, just a different background, maybe a different religion, but that's all. And a terrorist is a terrorist. I don't accept this view of freedom fighters one day, terrorists one day, freedom fighters the next. No, no. And if they'd been, if they had wanted to, they could have executed him, seriously. And then he wouldn't have had all this fuss of I can live 27 years in prison.
It might have been better if they had.
Well, he was a terrorist.
So how strong were the pro-South African, the pro-apartheid regime voices in the Conservative Party?
I think one was aware of them, but if only because they were not far from Margaret Thatcher in their attitude.
Margaret Thatcher had an instinctive bond or understanding with those people.
Yes.
Tempers seem to be running a bit high there, but I suppose that's...
Well, mine isn't.
At summit after summit, Margaret Thatcher resisted the calls for sanctions against the apartheid regime. She belittled one Commonwealth summit decision to limit trade on Krugerrands.
Tiny little bit. Do you know the value of Krugerrands that are imported? £500,000.
In London for the funeral of Margaret Thatcher, the last white leader of South Africa, F.W. de Klerk, claimed her approach, privately calling for change and resisting sanctions, allowed him to bring colleagues with him on reform.
Those leaders who maintained constructive engagement with South Africa had a much greater influence on the National Party government than those who totally turned their back on us.
But what did Nelson Mandela himself think? On his first visit to London after his release, he didn't come here to meet Margaret Thatcher. Many saw that as an indication of what he thought of her. But on his second visit, he did. And two different theories were born of what he thought of her role in his struggle.
What an honour and a pleasure, Prime Minister, to meet you.
It was a marvellous meeting, and she admired him very much more at the end of it than she had at the beginning. And in that meeting, President Mandela never once said, "You are, I do wish you had supported sanctions, I would have been out much sooner." There was no hint of that. So I do feel that in President Mandela's own attitudes, there was at least ambivalence as to whether sanctions were really what got him released, whatever it might have been politic for him to say publicly at the request of the ANC.
I just am amazed that Thatcher and Charles Pearl think that or try to invent it. I mean, Nelson Mandela was always very clear. He came to meetings to thank those of us in the anti-apartheid movement worldwide who'd been with them. He was absolutely meticulous about that. He was, however, always the polite gentleman. And maybe Mrs. Thatcher and her acolytes were rather taken in by this politeness and the sense of decorum and dignity that he always had. He wasn't going to be rude to Margaret Thatcher, of course not.
But his private thoughts?
His private thoughts were totally contemptuous. I know, because I discussed it with him. He felt totally betrayed by Britain, by the British Parliament, by the British government that he revered.
None of that on show when he spoke to MPs and peers. But he knew his name was barely mentioned in Parliament for the first 20 years of his detention. David Cameron signing the Book of Remembrance at the South African High Commission today. He has in the past spoken of conservative mistakes over South Africa. There was a 23-year-old researcher at the Conservative Party. He went on a trip to apartheid South Africa, paid for by a firm opposing sanctions. For years, Britain's support for Nelson Mandela's cause, for the sanctions he wanted, was a lot patchier than you might think, looking at the signs of respect everywhere on show today.
Gary Gibbon reporting.